First tonight, everybody has an opinion about this year's Super Bowl ads, what worked and what didn't work. Joining us for expert analysis is David Warschawski, CEO of Warschawski Integrated Marketing Communications. Thank you for being with us.
Great to be here, Jeff.
Good to see you again. So the ratings were down, I saw.
Yep.
Third year in a row, still 100 million people, which kind of makes it the Super Bowl of advertising.
It does. It is the Super Bowl of advertising. If you compare that to the World Cup in the United States, you had 25 million people tune in for that. You have over 100 million people tuning in. So all the eyeballs, the vast majority of eyeballs in the United States are concentrated on one place.
Say your agency wanted to buy a 30-second spot to promote the agency. What can you do in 30 seconds? What can't you do?
Well, there's a lot that you can do, and you saw the different varieties of ads that different brands were playing this year. But overwhelmingly, the counsel would be for most brands that a Super Bowl ad is not the right place for them to be spending their money, especially today with the digital marketing tactics that are out there, the ability to really finely target and to create exacting ROI. It's really only the deep-pocketed brands and those who want to be very aggressive who are going to advertise in the Super Bowl.
Whose line was it pre-internet that half of my ad budget is wasted? I just don't know which half.
I believe it was
right?
Ringling.
Ringling. Let's start with some of the spots that
sure.
you liked. We have a couple of clips. Won't play the whole thing, obviously, but this is an unusual soap commercial. Take a look.
Yeah, just your typical Super Bowl car ad, right?
Or a hilarious beer ad.
Or whatever ad this is.
Whatever.
But it's a Tide ad.
What?
It's a Tide ad.
What makes it a Tide ad?
There are no stains. Look at those clean clothes. What else would this be an ad for?
Diamonds?
A gift that lasts forever.
No, Tide.
It's time for a cold refresh.
Tied up.
Fall into the sleep of
no.
All right, so this goes on, and this played during the game. I have to confess, I missed a lot of the ads because the game was really
was good
this
game.
Year. Exactly. But they played little snippets along that theme. What did you think of it?
This was great. We've been waiting for some innovation in the advertisements during Super Bowl. We got two big innovations. So first was this spot. This is another Tide commercial. Essentially what Tide did was co-opt or hijack other companies' advertisements. So throughout the evening, you're wondering, is that an ad that's going to be for Tide or is that an ad for Old Spice?
Every time you saw a truck.
Right, you weren't sure
right.
where this was going. So a real stroke of genius, a great way to own the Super Bowl, money well spent, Procter & Gamble. Touchdown, that was as well played as you possibly can get it.
Okay, but are they going to sell any more detergent next week because of it?
So that's a great question. That goes to the heart of, is this worth the money or is it not? So I would tell you that I think they will be selling considerably more detergent over the next month. But the question that a company like Procter & Gamble and Tide looks at in its competitive market space is, are we building the brand equity that makes a point of differentiation that when I'm standing trying to decide which detergent to buy, oh yeah, I remember that ad. That was really clever. Everything that is around Tide is always clean. I need things to always be clean. This is the right brand for me.
Let's remind our viewers, if you have a question or comment about your favorite Super Bowl ad, you can give us a call. We'll have the number up on the screen. You can also tweet your questions. The Twitter address is at MPT News. Now, there's a campaign that's made quite an impact. A lot of football buys. This beer ad that's been running in a lot of football games for Bud Light. And they've turned this nonsense phrase, dilly-dilly, into something. They were on the air last night. What do you think of that?
So they really had momentum going into the Super Bowl, and I think they overplayed the hand, and they didn't really execute well with it. In general, Bud Light has always had great entries into the Super Bowl. I think this year they came out in the middle of the pack. Had they stuck with the first ad and left it alone where the king says, we're completely out of Bud Light, but they've still got Bud Light, let's attack, and they all ran to attack. That still fit into the sort of overall approach they had taken. But introducing the Bud Knight, it really started to fall downhill after that.
There was a spot that seemed moving. It was the voice of Martin Luther King Jr.
Right.
It was a truck commercial, but there was some negative backlash from that. What do you think?
I think it was reminiscent, and maybe they were trying to copy And God Made a Farmer, that Ram commercial, which was really a standout a couple of years ago. And I think they just didn't think this one through all the way and the possible negatives for it. It's a shame because they had a great entry with the Vikings piece that aired a couple of minutes earlier. Really strong, really on brand, fun, captured all of the key points that we look for in scoring advertisements. Then to come back with this ad, wish they wouldn't have.
Let's take a phone call. Prince George's County, this is Harriet. Harriet, thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Hi. You know, the commercial that I really enjoyed was the baby that was born without feet and she ended up skiing. I don't know. That should have been number one.
That was powerful. Thank you very much.
I thought it was.
Anything, Harriet, you didn't like?
I don't remember the Tide one. I mean, that's what you're talking about. That went over
Interesting.
My head.
Interesting. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's talk about Budweiser. So we talked about Bud Light. This was a Budweiser ad that we have a short clip from that sort of goes in a different direction. Take a look.
I'll be right there.
Now, the storm is affecting thousands of families, people still in desperate need of aid.
When the night has come.
Where were we at?
We've got Dan's order.
And the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me.
Production in all of these spots is just beautiful. I mean, I guess if you're spending, well, that would have been at least a $10 million play. It was a minute long.
Correct.
You don't shoot it on your iPhone, I guess.
No, and that's something that gets lost in the conversation. It's $5 million for a 30-second spot, so an average of roughly $166,000 per second. But if you're doing a great commercial like that, you need to invest money in the production and the pre-marketing and the post-marketing. So most people are spending well above $5 million to put their ad together.
Now, is that one going to sell Budweiser indirectly?
So I think it reinforces the brand tremendously. We always score ads on our Warschawski best model, and we look at four metrics. B, is it brand-centric? E, does it create an emotional connection with its target audience? S, does it stand out and is it memorable? And T, is there a clear target audience and a clear business goal? So here you're looking at Americana, hardworking Joe and Jill's doing the right thing by their country, very brand-centric, very emotionally tugging at the heartstrings. Stand out, who expects a beer company to fill up their beer cans with water?
I'd be really disappointed.
It would be a funny
surprise.
Unless
I needed water, right. Let's go out to the phones, Montgomery County. This is Ken. Ken, thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Hi. Yeah, at the beginning of the interview, David mentioned there were two innovative things, and the Tide commercial was one of the innovative ones. Did I miss the second innovative one?
Thank you, Ken, for the follow-up question. Appreciate it.
You did not, Ken. We didn't get a chance to talk about it. The second one, which was also tremendously groundbreaking, was the Mountain Dew Doritos commercial, where you had Morgan Freeman in a rap battle against Peter Dinklage. I mean, this was so on brand for the two of them, but it's the first time in Super Bowl history, as far as I know, even advertising history, where you have two major brands in the same ad going head to head, but yet to the benefit of each of the ads. Incredibly well done, fun spot, perfect for who their target audience is.
Howard County, this is Judith. Judith, thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Hi. I had a comment about Budweiser, the Budweiser ads.
Mm-hmm.
For many years, what made that company rather special, rather unique, and they were kind, they were interesting, they were humorous, was the use of those great big beautiful horses carrying the beer wagons and the creative ad writing that went along with it. It was great, but it was different. Now they're just a beer company. Who cares?
Thanks very much for the phone call. Was the only appearance of a Clydesdale in the Tide spot?
Yes, and it's actually a wonderful point is Bud moved away from some of the things it's done traditionally. And one of the most iconic, probably in most people's book, top five Super Bowl ads of all times is when the Clydesdale take a knee after 9/11.
Wow. Interesting. Let's go to Washington County, talk to Robert. Robert, you're on MPT. Go ahead.
Yes, I was wondering about the non-commercial where the coaches on both sides seem to be holding a Waffle House menu.
That would be a great product placement. I mean, certainly when the NFL does an instant replay review,
right,
they're holding up a Microsoft tablet.
Right.
And then you see the guy squint into it, so you're not sure how.
Right. I didn't know that I saw Waffle House menus, but I think I know what you're going for. Product placement has become a big part of it, how you extend the life of a commercial and extend the value of your $5 million has become a big part of the game. If you remember in the past, the Bud was up. That became a catchphrase that lived well beyond the actual commercial and Super Bowl. I think Pringles this year was a great example of that with their Wow commercial, trying to create a new catchphrase that could extend beyond the Super Bowl.
So what's it like watching the Super Bowl at your house? You're there with a clipboard in front of the television?
I'm there with a computer taking notes. I'm the least fun person to watch the Super Bowl with. No beer, very little food, and just paying attention to something that I really love, both sports and the advertising industry.
Before we go, give me the state of marketing communications in just a minute. What are you focused on these days?
It's great, especially digital marketing. We just became a Google Partner Agency. It's a prestigious award for a Baltimore-based agency, and the ability to do very targeted digital marketing with clear ROI, and some of them are even free, some of the things that you can do, is really game-changing, especially for some of the mid-sized to smaller organizations that are out there.
And may not have $5 million for the airtime.
Exactly.
David Warschawski, thank you very much, sir.
Pleasure seeing you.
Just ahead.